The second section of the proof involves shifting the analysis to the GFT domain. It is, indeed, the time for us to shift the analysis into the graph Fourier transform domain. Recall then that we are using Vi to denote the eigenvectors of S. From the definition of the inverse GFT, we know that we can write an input signal X as the product of the eigenvector matrix V and the GFT X tilde. This product can be alternatively written as the product of xi tilde times v sub I, where the xi tilde are the components of the GFT of X, and the v sub I are the eigenvectors of S, as we have just recalled. What is most important to remember in this equation is that the coefficients xi tilde are the components of the GFT of the input signal X. Using this expression for x, we can write the product delta of s times x as a summation of products of the form delta of s times v sub I, each of them scaled by their respective graph Fourier transform coefficient xi tilde. Further, using the definition of delta of s in 23 yields the expression we show in 25. This expression looks complicated, but this is only because it has several terms. In its derivation, we have just replaced delta of S for its definition in 23 and used the GFT of the signal X to write the product delta of S times X as a summation of products of the form delta of S times Vi, each of them multiplied by the GFT coefficient X tilde. Considering now that v sub I is an eigenvector of S, we have that S to the power of k minus r times Vi equals lambda I to the power of k minus r times Vi. And likewise, that S to the k minus r plus 1 times Vi equals lambda I to the k minus r plus 1 times Vi. By using these facts, we can simplify 25 to the expression in 26, where really all we have done is replace powers of S by corresponding powers of lambda I. We are now going to use the decomposition we stated in the eigenvector perturbation lemma. We are going to do that because in 26, a term of the form E times Vi has appeared. And in the eigenvector perturbation lemma, we have decomposed this product of E and Vi as the summation of a product between the scalar M sub I with Vi and a product between a matrix E sub I with Vi. Utilizing this decomposition in 26, we end up with the terms in 27 and 28, which are the ones we need to study to conclude the proof of the theorem. We are going to prove two facts. The first fact is related to the first term, which is relatively easy to handle. In any event, this fact, which we will call fact 1, says that if we let delta 1 of S times X represent the term in 27, its norm can be bounded by 2 times C times epsilon, as we show in 29. This bound holds for any vector X that has unit norm. The second fact is a little more difficult to handle, but we will prove that the following fact holds. If we denote the term in equation 28 as delta 2 of S times X, its norm can be bounded by 2 times C times delta times the square root of N times epsilon, as we show in 30. This bound also holds for any vector that has unit norm, and this fact we are going to call it fact 2. Before we move on to their proofs, let us see how we can put fact 1 and fact 2 together. Because the difficult part of the proof is to prove fact 1 and fact 2. Assuming they hold, the rest of the proof of the theorem is about putting pieces in place. We have already proven in 23 that the operator norm modulo permutation of the difference between the filters h of s hat and h of s, which is the quantity we want to bound, is upper bounded by the sum of the norms of delta of S and O of E. And the term O of E, we have already seen, is of order epsilon squared in equation 22. If we assume they hold, it is ready to use fact 1 and fact 2 to bound the operator norm of delta of S. To that end, we use the definition of the operator norm to write the operator norm of delta of S as the maximum over all vectors with unit norm of the regular norm of the delta of S times x. If we further use the expression for delta of S times x that we derived in 27 and 28, along with the triangle inequality for the maximization operation, we can further bound the operator norm of delta of S as two separate maximizations, both of them over vectors of unit norm, but one of them maximizing the norm of the expression in 27, and the other one maximizing the norm of the expression in 28. But these are also the expressions that appear in fact 1 and fact 2. They correspond to the definitions of delta 1 times x and delta 2 times x. We can therefore use fact 1 to bound 33, and we can use fact 2 to bound 34. The result is a term, 2c epsilon, coming from 33, bounded as in fact 1, and a term, 2c delta square root of n epsilon, coming from 34, bounded as in fact 2. To conclude the proof, substitute the bound in 35 into the bound in 31. Recall again that the norm of O of E is of order epsilon squared, as stated in 21. The proof is complete because these substitutions yield the theorem's claim in equation 7.